Hello, my name is Sarah, and I'm a graduate student at the University of Guelph. I would like to welcome you to the College of Arts Convocation Ceremony this morning. The University of Guelph is honored by our graduands, and we take pride in this convocation. I'd like to tell you a little bit about the proceedings today. The ceremonials used for conferring degrees have evolved over the millennium, and the gowns and hoods represent that history. In general, the gowns for the baccalaureate and the magisteriate degrees are black, and the color of the hood is different for each degree program. The doctorates at the University of Guelph have a bright blue gown, and the honorary degrees are red. The University of Guelph crest that you can see on the curtains behind me and shown on the cover of the convocation program also represent our specific history. The emblems in the crest show links with the royal city of Guelph through the white stallion above, the connections to the liberal arts through the book, to the sciences through the astrolab, and our connection to abundance and agriculture through the cornucopia. The University of Guelph motto, Rerum Cognoscere Causis, is a quote from Virgil. It is variously translated to be either happy is the one who is able to ascertain the reason of things, or perhaps to know the reason of things. The procession of people in the hall are also influenced by ancient tradition. The piper will herald the start of the procession of graduands, the students who are graduating today. This will be followed by the arrival of the mace leading the platform party. The mace is a symbol of authority at the university and will be carried by the beadle. In medieval universities, a beadle was chosen by the instructor to work as an assistant. Today, the beadle is a ceremonial officer of Senate. Following the beadle and the mace is the vice chancellor, members of the administration and the honorees, fellows of the university, members of the board and Senate, and members of faculty and staff. The degrees will be conferred in the order that you see in your program. The degrees are separated by categories, representing the specific degree being awarded within the college. We'll begin with doctorates and magisteriates, followed by baccalaureate degrees. The name reader will present scholars to the vice chancellor by degree category. As the name of each student is called, the beadle will place the hood over the recipient's shoulders. This moment will be videoed, and technology willing, there will be a simultaneous live cast of the event to allow family members and friends to watch from a distance. The vice chancellor will greet each student at center stage, and a photograph will be taken. We understand the joy and excitement of accompanying such an auspicious occasion, but we ask that you hold your applause until each group of graduands have crossed the stage. There will be an opportunity for a truly thunderous applause. Once all degrees are conferred and the cheers are cheered, the vice chancellor will close the ceremony and a recessional will play. Please remain standing during the recessional until all the platform has processed out of the hall. Our colleagues from Alumni Affairs are hosting a social media program developed especially for convocation. Please share your photos, memories, and advice with graduating students by joining us on social media using the hashtag GuelphGrad. Finally, may I be the first person to congratulate the graduands on their various successes and offer my congratulations to the family and friends who are here to support them. Welcome to the convocation at the University of Guelph.
hearts we see thee rise, the true north, strong and free. From far and wide, O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. God keep our land glorious and free. O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. O Canada, we stand on guard for thee.
On this day of celebration, we pause and reflect on our place in this world. Today we acknowledge the Attawandaran people on whose traditional territory the University of Guelph now resides. And we offer our respect to their Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and Métis neighbors. On this day that marks the end of a journey, we give thanks. We give thanks for the friendships that have been forged along the way. We are grateful for those who have supported us, faculty, staff, mentors, and families. I invite you, each in your own way, to take a moment of silence, to reflect, to recognize that for which you are grateful, to offer a prayer. In light of the events in Orlando, and today as we step into a new tomorrow, may the knowledge that we have gained here at the University of Guelph be coupled with wisdom and infused with compassion and clothed with humility, that we might contribute to the flourishing of all humanity, that we might embrace the forgotten, enhance the sustainability of all things, and fully discover together what it means to be human. May grace and peace abound. You may be seated.
Members of the board, honorary fellows and faculty of the university, family and friends, and graduates, welcome to the celebration of convocation here at the University of Guelph. I'd like to also extend a particular welcome to today's convocation speaker, Professor Dion Brand. Welcome. My name is Franco Vaccarino, and I have the honor and the privilege of serving as the president and the vice chancellor of this great university. And I'm privileged today to welcome all of you here to convocation. So as we begin convocation today, let me offer a few congratulatory remarks. First off, graduates, this is your big day. You've worked hard. You've persevered, and you've made it. Well done, well deserved. So graduation day is all about transition, moving from one thing to another, from one state to another. It's one of a number of important transitions that I'm sure you've already made and will continue to make as your lives unfold. Last fall, I had the opportunity to welcome our new first-year students to the University of Guelph, and I reminded them that besides being the incoming class of 2015 at the time, they're also the graduating class of 2019. That was a moment of traveling forward in time. And just for a moment, I'd like to travel back in time with you to your own arrival here just a few years ago. Remember how it felt to set foot for the first time as new students on this campus. A mixture of excitement as well as anticipation, nervousness, maybe confidence, hope, and fear all kind of bundled together at the same time. Well, you figured it out. Exploring campus, navigating through your classes and labs, finding new friends, mentors, perhaps discovering the wider community of Guelph. and maybe most importantly, discovering just a little bit more about yourselves. It was a time of transition, going from what you were to what you would become, including, by the way, becoming griffins. Now it's a time for your next transition. And maybe you're feeling a similar or familiar mix of hope and optimism together with some trepidation and uncertainty. So think back over the past few years of your studies here at Guelph. You leave us today having gained new knowledge and having had the opportunity to study and work with renowned teachers, absolute world-class researchers. And as part of a learning-centered, research-intensive campus, you've witnessed breakthroughs in scholarship and research here. You've been part of a diverse, welcoming community that's open to differing opinions, as well as shared learning and discovery. And I would suggest that what you've learned goes well beyond strict subject matter. An important part of our mission as a university has been to provide you with the tools to successfully adapt and navigate through the complexities and dynamics of modern society. In our fast-paced world, the gap has narrowed between knowledge generation and knowledge application. New ideas become new products at truly an unprecedented pace. Information and communications technologies, and the related democratization of learning and knowledge have really become game changers. Effectively, what's happened is that the distance between today and tomorrow has narrowed. Now, that presents challenges, of course, but it also presents enormous opportunities for all of us. A key challenge with change and transition is uncertainty, the very thing that some of you may be feeling right now. And of course, it is a challenge, but it's also a wonderful opportunity. And the opportunity lies in what I like to think of or call the upside of uncertainty. Taking uncertainty and change, adapting to it in a healthy way, and turning it into a positive, turning it into an opportunity. So what does that mean? Well, here on campus, it means that our researchers and scholars, they confront uncertainty by anticipating problems and opportunities and by developing solutions, including, by the way, solutions to problems that don't even exist yet. So not only do we anticipate and develop solutions, but we also anticipate problems down the line before they happen. For you graduates, it means building on all that you have learned, getting the job done, and getting it done well. All that while being future thinkers, thinking ahead. Here at Guelph, we've tried to help you learn to adapt to and indeed to thrive in tomorrow's ever-changing world. We have looked to provide not just a curriculum for you, but also the life skills or tools to your lifelong survival kit. So today, you face a new transition. Some of you will continue on to graduate school, others will enter the working world, and still others will travel or otherwise take time to ponder your next steps. Whatever your next move, here at Guelph, we have provided you with the analytical and qualitative skills that you need to look beyond the world today and to succeed through innovation and problem solving in new and important ways. You have learned about adaptation and creativity, and probably improvisation too. In effect, you've learned how to learn, learning to learn, and that has never been more important, I think, than in today's world. And that's a good thing. As you leave behind the formal classrooms and labs, your learning does not end today. In many ways, it really is just the beginning. It's about lifelong learning, and you'll discover this in the months and years ahead. The process of learning and adapting and applying that learning in new and exciting ways over your entire careers and actually over your entire lifetimes. You've spent the past few years as part of the university community, and I hope you've also had the chance to learn about how you fit into that wider community. Because taking that wider view will be essential for you in tomorrow's world. Over the years, you will see that you will bring together different perspectives. You'll need to bring together different perspectives. Blend knowledge and ideas from different disciplines and apply that knowledge in innovative, exciting, and fresh ways. We like to use the expression knowledge in action. It's about bringing that knowledge to life in powerful ways for your own lives and the lives of others. And it's also about finding that upside of uncertainty. So as you enter this exciting next stage of your lives, I encourage you all to draw upon all of your University of Guelph experiences as learners and also as members of a very special community, and to bring the best that you have to offer to every experience. Continue to taking pride in your achievements. Embrace the opportunities when they arrive, and they will arrive. Look to create your own opportunities, opportunities that will shape your future, our future, opportunities to redefine who we are, to see the future through a broader lens. You know, universities are among the few places in society where a large part of our purpose is to foster ideas and innovation, as well as to dream and to inspire hope. So I encourage you all to find ways to take what you've learned here, to engage with, really make a difference in your world, in our world. Oh, and one more thing. And this one actually is not so much about uncertainty, it's about certainty. One thing's for certain, once a Griffin, always a Griffin. Thank you very much. Thank you. Let me now take this opportunity to talk to you a little bit about this morning's convocation speaker. This morning's convocation address will be delivered by Professor Dion Brand, professor and university research chair in the School of English and Theater Studies. Professor Brand is a renowned poet, novelist, and an essayist. She has published some 18 books, contributed to many anthologies, written dozens of essays and articles, and made documentary films for the National Film Board. She's received numerous awards for her work, amongst which are the Governor General's Award for Poetry in 1997 and the Griffin Prize for Poetry in 2011. She was named the Poet Laureate of the City of Toronto in 2009. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm absolutely delighted to invite Professor Brand to now give the convocation address.
Thank you. Hi, good morning. What a lovely morning for you. First, I want to congratulate you on this notable day. This degree and this ceremony are markers for you, I know, passageways, kind of full of light to your future life. Well, let me begin with an admission of my own, though, about such a morning, which I missed. I have to admit that I did not attend my own graduation at the University of Toronto in 1975. I was in such an intense hurry to change the world and to get to my life as a writer that while I took the photo, do you take an official photo? So I took the official photo to send to my family to prove that I had finished, because they didn't quite believe that I might do that. But I didn't attend the ceremony. So allow me to vicariously graduate with you today. Yeah. And in joining you in this celebration, it takes me back to that time and to a time before and to the reasons that I studied English literature. My study of literature, I think, began truly perhaps in my grandmother's lap in a house in a village called Guayguayari, 10 degrees above the equator with the sea outside and the sound of the surf there. She, sitting in a rocking chair on the veranda, would tell stories about mythic beings and, most importantly, transgressive women. They used to be called bad women. Now they're called transgressive. Those were my first classes in literature, and perhaps my first classes in psychology and in feminism. There was, too, the figure of my grandfather reading the newspaper every morning and every luxurious Sunday with his tea and his glasses and his gristly mustache, commenting about the political situation in the world. And those were my first classes in philosophy and history. And then there was the radio my family listened to from the French Antilles and the nearby Venezuela coast. And those were my teachers in languages. And my lessons in fine art, in costume, in mask, and music came from the yearly carnival that made its way for 2 days every year through all the streets of my childhood. My graduation from this first school awarded no document unless you count carrying the sounds, the cadence, the moral, ethical, and aesthetic temperature of those two people and of that time, its languages and its theater, into the rest of my life. That graduation took place on a plane flying to Toronto, with the thought in my 17-year-old fragile brain of becoming a writer. Landing, I entered the academics of literature, the classes in Old and Middle English, Restoration, Romanticism, 18th and 19th century and contemporary European, Caribbean, Latin American, African and African American literature, and to philosophy, Plato, Kant, Hobbes, Locke, and finally, and gratefully, in the end, Marx and Engels. Well, so I missed my BA convocation because I was just too busy. I was in a really big hurry to synthesize all that I had read and learned into books of my own. And also, as a gesture to that idea that I had not attended university merely for certification. The piece of paper, as we used to call it, was not the reason that I had sat up nights thinking about Aimé Césaire's Cahier d'un retour au pays natal. And I could hear that poem, Au bout du petit matin, sous cette plus fragile épaisseur de terre, des dépasses de façon humiliante, son grandiose avenir, volcanoes will explode and water will carry full spots of the sun. Nor was it why the sharp realism of Charles Dickens's Hard Times woke me. It was not why I read Virginia Woolf, nor why I read Luigi Pirandello, nor why I adored Lorraine Hansberry and can still hear her words in my head saying, love? Ah, ask the troubadours who come from those who have loved when all reason pointed to the uselessness and foolhardiness of love. Perhaps we shall be the teachers when it is done, out of the depths of pain we have thought to be our sole heritage in this world. Oh, we know about love. Have you read Lorraine Hansberry? Well, go do it tomorrow. And the piece of paper was not why I'd read the poems of Langston Hughes. He had a lovely little haiku and it went like, the cool, clear face of the water asked me for a kiss. It's a kind of a riddle. Nor why I had read the poems of Pablo Neruda or Gwendolyn Brooks. And here's a Brooks poem. We real cool, we left school, we lurk late, we strike straight, we sing sin, we thin gin, we jazz June, we die soon. Nor was it why I discovered and adored Brecht, Bertolt Brecht, for saying, amongst the highly placed, it is considered low to talk about food. The fact is, they have already eaten. The lowly must leave this earth without having tasted any good meat. For wondering where they come from and where they are going, the fine evenings find them too exhausted. They have not yet seen the mountains and the great sea when their time is already up. If the lowly do not think about what's low, they will never rise. That's Bertolt Brecht. He has beautiful poems too. It was not why I wrote that essay on Herbert Marcuse's One-Dimensional Man, nor the essay on Frantz Fanon's Wretched of the Earth. And why did I spend so many gloomy hours with Sartre's Being and Nothingness? Have you spent similar hours with that? Well, like you, I did all this. I read all this. I worked it through. I thought it through for my life. Literature itself, representing the lives of others near and far, complicated and surreal, contemplative and intuitive, had accredited me. I know that you graduates from your various disciplines must feel this way too, that you have done these years, read voraciously, thought deeply, agonized on the metaphysical and the moral and the ethical in those classrooms for your life. Okay, second confession. I must confess that I spent most of my undergraduate life in the pub. After all that, right? You know, but But in the pub, I learned to drink beer, talk loudly, love far too dangerously, weep over the sound of a singer and a band, or the sound of poetry, stagger home with serious heartbreak, and make a big fool of myself altogether. These, I know now, were equally important skills for an academic life. For a life, really, you know. In the pub, debates ensued at that time about South Africa, about the US, about European imperialism, about colonialism, Vietnam, the Sir George Williams University, immigration, radicalism, South America, and just the meaning of everything. Okay? So the pub was equally important as the classroom. Today, I know that you can list your list of arguments, I'm sure reflect mine, to some degree. I know you've worked for a just world, a clean environment, Aboriginal rights, LGBTQ rights, anti-racism, and human rights for feminism. I know you have joined Idle No More, Black Lives Matter, Eco-Justice, and the many humanist urgencies that we live now. You've done the right thing. Someone said, it is by our will and conscience that we make the world. You know, there is a cynical mantra that says, you will grow out of these things when the real world hits you. I want to tell you that you won't. And if you ever feel that that's happening, don't. Yeah? Never inhabit that cynicism. This is the real world that you and I are living in, where care and empathy and vision must be keenly felt, keenly lived, where guided by our passion, we never turn a blind eye on injustice. This is the real. The other is becoming numb to the world and the senses. As an undergraduate, many people ask me, why was I doing a degree in English? Why was I studying philosophy? What kind of job would I get from that? I hear echoes, echo, echo, yeah. Why didn't I do something more worthwhile? And by worthwhile, they meant something about money. I understand, we need to pay the rent, that is true. But I answered that I was doing literature for my life so that I could live a life of the mind, so that when what they considered worthwhile fell apart or gave out or wasn't sufficient to explain the world nor my place in it, I would still have a life. Becoming a writer entailed taking a certain vow of poverty, naturally. And each year, I renew these vows happily because literature allowed me a great space to practice what Paul Valéry called the ancient craft of the beautiful. And the space that this craft has opened in me is the payment, the open field that art allows, the electrified synapse in the brain, the way a life deepens, the more elaborate a human being I may become, attending to history, attending to the social, attending to possibility. You know, I was at a reading in Calgary with my novel, What We All Long For, was published, and a woman was waiting in the book line, and she came up to me afterward, and the book was in part about a Vietnamese family who had arrived in Toronto after the Vietnam War, and they were wrecked and broken, having lost their young son in the crush and panic to escape. And the woman approached me weeping, and she said, how did you know? How did you know? And I was taken aback at first, and then I understood what she was saying, and rose to comfort her. She had been a refugee from Vietnam herself and found a similarity between herself and the characters in the book, kinship. That is what literature means. That is what art means. That is what the humanities mean, solidarity with other human beings. The Chilean poet Pablo Neruda wrote in his Nobel speech, there is no insurmountable solitude. I want to give you this sentence. There is no insurmountable solitude. That is the core idea of the humanities. I was happy to offer that kinship and that solidarity to her and to have it rendered to me in return. This is how I get paid for a life in art, and I have amassed a massive fortune, really. I'm looking out at you now, and you look wonderful. You really do, okay? You look shiny, you look ready, you look full of vigor, and I know you did not come here, and I know you came here for your life, and you went through those 4 years and the pub for your life. Yeah, which is your great fortune. Once, I was doing a little oral history project. The name of it turned out to be No Burden to Carry, and I had taken that name, No Burden to Carry, from a woman in Buxton. It was an oral history of a black community, small black community, Buxton. And she was telling me how people felt about education at the time in the 40s and 50s that she was talking about. And she said, education is no burden to carry, and no one can take it away from you. So that's the second sentence I want to leave you with. Some of you will go into politics, some will go into teaching, some into the art world, some into social work, community work, healing work, so many paths you have. Because the humanities are life-sustaining, they are world-remaking. You, graduates of the College of Art, let me tell you, you are very important to the world. Just think for a moment what it will be without you. There'll be a barrenness. There will be no human, no humane voice. So I am happy for you today. I wish you joy. You have my kinship and solidarity. I've probably taught a few of you over the last 4 years, and you have been a revelation to me. I have learned a lot from you. But to all of you, I want to say, go make something happen, right? Like, go do something wonderful in the world. Well, I know you probably have a student's loan, but don't worry about it. Forget about it, just live large. Live really big. This is your only responsibility. So I'm charging you with a few things, and I'm only asking because you have the capacity to do them, because you are thinkers, you are intellectuals, you are ethicists, you are expressionists. Go make a different world. You have a responsibility to the planet, make it clean. Go stop the commercial debris orbiting the Earth. Go stop the continent of plastic waste in that whirlpool in the Pacific. Have you heard about that, right? You know, go stop the deluge of oil waiting to be spewed into the oceans, and go heal the scarred landscapes. Stop the rapacious capital. Go make sure everybody eats and not just a few. And go open some child's mind to the books that have opened your mind. Get justice for Aboriginal communities in this country, something generations in this country have refused to do. I think you can do that, right? Go bring an end to homophobia and sexism and racism. I think you can do that. Go make the world you want to live in. When you think of what you are going to do next, ask yourself whether it measures what Paul Valéry calls a definition of art, to construct and to refrain from destruction. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Professor Brandt, for wise and beautiful words and the commitment not only for graduates but for all of us to live larger than we currently do. Thank you. Well, graduates, this is now your moment. Will the graduating class please rise? Mr. Vice Chancellor, I have the honor to present to you these scholars who have fulfilled the statutory requirements laid down by the Senate of the University of Guelph that they may be admitted to their various and several degrees.
By virtue of the authority vested in me and in the University of Guelph, I hereby accept you for admission to your various and several degrees with all the rights, privileges, and obligations appertaining thereto. Please join me in congratulating these scholars on their terrific accomplishments. Well done. Well done.
And now, will members of the graduating class please be seated?
Okay, we're at that moment. This part of the journey is coming to an end. We actually get to see them come across the stage and receive their degrees. We encourage you to express your joy and happiness through hoops, hollers, leaping in the air. All of those things are fine. But one thing, please, could you hold your applause until after each group has gone through? We have three groups. I'll let you know when the moment has come. Mr. Vice Chancellor, I have the honor to present to you these scholars from the College of Arts that they may be admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Arts Honors Program. Garnet Hugh Atkin Watts Abel. Rihanna Marie Alexander. Adam Nelson Bernards. Kayla Nicole Bessie. Namerita Bui. Anne Elizabeth Burkhoff. Ariel Bissett with distinction. Morgan Page Bond. Brock Ethan Boonstra with distinction. Marie Ruth Both with distinction. David Sorenzia. Katie P. Y. Chung with distinction. Brandon Walfick Shogri. Edward G. Luau Chow. Victoria Joan Chubb. Christine Elizabeth Clark. Peter Emilio Clark with distinction. Anthony Camiso. Christine Elizabeth Cousins with distinction. Kimberly Craig. Taylor Danielle Curley. Jennifer Marie Daniels. Jordan Nicole Denton. Danielle Kirsten DeFruscia with distinction. Christina Marie Downey. Sinead May Duffy. Robin Dunbar with distinction. Grace Evers with distinction. Chloe Mercedes Fabry. John Emmett Fallon with distinction. Erica Elizabeth Anastasia Farfaris with distinction. Callum Farrell. The next degree is for Kaya Firth. This degree is awarded posthumously, and Kaya's mother, Jenna Firth, will accept the degree. Brennan Leanne Sarah Francis. Katrina Gonzalez. Catherine Hamilton Goosens. Cassie Caitlin Gottschalk. Caitlin Lois Graham, with distinction. Jacqueline Grattan. Emma Green. Jeffrey Scott Hewitt. Justine Elizabeth Haywood. Timothy Andrew Hoover, with distinction. Mackenzie Alyssa Horvat. Thomas Grant Warner Howell. Shane George Norris Hubbard. Rachel Isaac, with distinction. Jeremy Eisted, with distinction. Zainab Sira Jakta. Natasha Leah Jarrett, with distinction. Sarah Jane Johnston. Cassandra Cook, with distinction. Charlotte Jane Eleanor Levay. Vanessa Lo Mendonca. Alan Craig Cruz Lynn. Elizabeth Ellen McDonald. Jennifer Catherine McCluskey. Taylor Paige McDonald. James Peter McPherson McLeod. Carly Jean Meredith, with distinction. Melissa Montanari, with distinction. Kyla Cherise Montour. Fiona Moore. T- Tanner Jeffrey Hugh Morton. Lara Alessandra Murphy. Joshua Michael Muscat. Carson Alexander Orem. William Richard O'Shea, with distinction. Crystal Jean Parkinson. Dana K. Plant, with distinction. Cherise Ragunath. Mark Gregory Rapley, with distinction. Elizabeth Grace Richardson, with distinction. Madeline Sarah Rosenberg, with distinction. Samantha Golda Roth. Allison Rush. Sarah Elizabeth Iris Rickman. Connor Francis Salmon. Megan Victoria Scott. Megan Elizabeth Shuchuk. Elena Nicole Schwabi. Brock Martin Richard Smith. Nicholas Esmond Stavro Shodoff. Emily M. Stroyan. Ian Keith Crozier Thutt, with distinction. Juan Sebastian Toro. Kelsey Linnea Wee. Brittany Nicole Waite. Emma Jane Welch. Jenny Mannon Wilson. Christopher Carl Withenshaw. Sarah Alexandra Zika. Let's congratulate this group of graduates. Mr. Vice Chancellor, I have the honor to present to you these scholars from the College of Arts that they may be admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Arts General Program. Natani Allison. Daniel Brisebois. Mary Patricia Callahan. Rachel Jane Craig. Woo! Derek John DeLange. Jacob Funikov. Devin Jean Gardner. Jordana Glassman. Thomas Harry Hebert. Zachary Paul Kennedy. Caitlin Link. Alexis Judith Liver. Elizabeth McMillan. Talia McMull. Kyle Dana Marsh. Elias McBean. Angela Helen Moreau. Joshua Shane Nightingale. Alicia Marie Paxton. Lexa Ray Robinson Briggs. Madeline Senegan with distinction. Scott Turner. Nicole Yee. And let's congratulate the second group of graduates. Mr. Vice Chancellor, I have the honor to present to you these scholars from the College of Arts that they may be admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Arts and Sciences Honors Program. Imran Baga, with distinction. Alexandra Kristen Bennett, with distinction. Francis Arsenis Compton. Leah Monique Dell'Orletta, with distinction. Madeline Marie Field, with distinction. Tamlin Rose Jody Friedman Couchman, with distinction. Samantha Ann Horton. Oh, yeah. Emelena Heyer. Kayla F. Jones. Nancy Barbosa Leal, with distinction. Brody Marks, with distinction. Ruth Shanika Nathaniel. Krista Michelle Kelsey O'Connor. Holly Elizabeth Otwell. Rebecca Linda Owen. Jenna Marie Patterson. Natalie Suzanne Sagar, with distinction. Vincent Rocky Spermuli. Emma Christine Story. Julia Marie Veit, with distinction. Anna Rebecca Wasserman, with distinction. Benjamin Hayes Williams, with distinction. And that's the third group.
And while we're in an applauding mood, can you please join me in thanking Dean Bruce for his masterful reading of all of your names? Mr. Vice Chancellor, I would ask you to confer the various and several degrees on the graduates listed in the program but unable to be present at this ceremony.
By virtue of the authority vested in me and in the University of Guelph, I confer the various and several degrees in absentia on the graduates not present. Thank you. Well, graduates, you did it. Congratulations. Well done. Well, in keeping with the theme of transitions, let me now welcome all of you to the Griffin alumni family. A growing family, this week, more than 3,400 new graduates are joining our alumni group. And the University of Guelph alumni now number more than 125,000 graduates around the world. As you can imagine, we're all very, very proud of your accomplishments here at the university and look forward to seeing how the foundations that you've developed here as a student will continue to support you in the years to come. We want to celebrate your achievements and your successes with you and do hope that you'll continue to stay in touch. And remember that you're always welcome here. Graduates, you have made so many memories here, I'm sure, including, of course, today's ceremony. And remember this as well. You're a student for a short time, but you're a Griffin forever. So well done. Now, this concludes our formal convocation ceremony. Dean Don Bruce will host a reception for all graduates and their guests in Creelman Hall. This is an opportunity to congratulate the graduates, and we do hope that you can attend. Graduates, a couple of orders of business here. Once you've taken all your photographs, please return the gowns and hoods to the tent outside the hall. Sometimes there's a tendency of just going straight off to the celebration, but if you could drop off your hoods and gowns, that would be great. And one more note, we are hosting 22 convocation ceremonies this week, and waiting outside is the next group of eager families to see their graduates across the stage. And to help us prepare the hall for that group, if you could please exit through the doors on the right and left of the stage. So thanks very much for that. Now, as tradition has it, the Vice Chancellor, that's me today, gets the final word, and the final words are, convocation is dismissed. Well done.